And we're live. Look at that. Awesome to be here. Hey, everybody, just check your sound real quick, Linda. Turn on your mic or your
Well, I'm not in.
Oh, okay.
Here we go. Hold on.
Once you're in, once you're checked in, that's great. All right. Awesome.
Sounds working.
Hey, everybody, how are you? It is Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. Welcome to the show. This is the What Would Jeff Do show. I do this as many times a week as I can, sometimes two, sometimes three. Sorry about last night's very late night cancellation, about an hour before. I had to rush to the emergency room. I broke I fractured a rib yesterday morning, 30 minutes before the seminar. If you check out my Instagram stories, you'll hear that story. So I got myself into this chair. Don't expect me to get out anytime soon. So I'll be here for at least an hour and a half. We got a 90-minute show, I think. I think Joelle's going to be popping in a little bit. If you're brand new to my world, can you just push that down arrow right there?
This right here?
Yep, one time. Yep, perfect. If you're brand new to my world, my name is Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training, and I own a dog training company up here in Providence, Rhode Island. I personally travel the world doing dog training seminars. We actually just finished one in Providence this past weekend. Some photos have started going up. Next weekend, I'll be in Elkhart, Indiana, and you'll be able to see photos and live streams and Instagram stories about that as well. We spend a lot of time on aggression rehab. We spend a lot of time on behavior modification. We pretty much spend a lot of time on stopping unwanted behaviors. Obviously, we train wanted behaviors as well. You'll never hear me talk science because nobody really gives a shit, frankly. They want their dogs to do stuff and stop doing stuff. And so it's all done through reward to increase behavior, to teach new behaviors, to reinforce existing behaviors, and then to eliminate unwanted behaviors, to decrease behaviors, and to suppress a behavior. And suppressing a behavior is not a bad thing. We use punishment. I freely use the word punishment because that is what it is. Punishment is not abuse. Punishment is you're not mad at your dog. You're not upset with your dog. You're not, you know, any of those things. It's just fact. It's just like, you can't do that anymore. The only way to stop an unwanted behavior is through punishment. You can argue as much as you want. I'm actually not going to listen to you. It's not because I don't have an open mind. I've got an extremely open mind. But because you're lying, and I'll have none of that. None of that nonsense. I'm direct. I'm to the point. The reason is because dogs are dying, and I'm sick and tired of all the unethical behavior in dog training. And I'm also starting to get tired of all the sugarcoating of people as well. People are afraid. People are scared. Nobody wants to talk about shock collars. Nobody wants to talk about punishment. But I've been doing it now for 12 years, and I'll continue to do it until more people realize that the only way to stop an unwanted behavior is through punishment. So a bunch of people have already done super chat, and you can see it right in your live stream. You see some brightly colored people like Greg from Do It Yourself Music Biz and Doggy Detour and Betsy Swanson. What they did, thank you so much.
Swenson,
thank you so much. What they did was they hit the little super chat button down below. There's a little dollar sign, and we really, really appreciate it. Some people do it not to get their question at the top of the feed. Some people do it just to say thank you for the thousands and thousands of free videos and the massive amount of free content that you put out. This is episode number 454. We've been doing this for a really long time. This is Linda. She's my wife. Don't ask her too many dog training questions because that's not what she does. She's just married to a dog trainer.
They could ask me other questions.
They can ask your own questions.
Not now, though.
About anything, right? Or anything. You've got your own show. All right, so let's start right at the top with Betsy. There you go, Betsy. What do you got?
Betsy, 8-month-old Lab Dalmatian mix pulls on walks. Got 3-millimeter prong collar in mail today. Watched your how-to, and I'm worried I should have gotten a 2.25. She's 55 pounds. Should I use 3-millimeter or exchange for 2.25?
I think this is the thing, Betsy. You know, you probably can fit into a 2.25, but you're probably going to have to add extra links. You're probably going to need the 3-millimeter anyway, because your dog will probably go up to about 70, 75 pounds. Let's keep that dog nice and lean, though, as they were meant to be. What I want you to do is you'll be taking out links, though. So not too many dogs need that whole collar as the manufacturer makes it. Almost on every single dog we work with, including some of our 100-pound dogs, probably need all of it. We actually had a 130-pound Mastiff at our seminar this past weekend. You'll absolutely be taking out links. All right, so definitely watch the video, watch how to introduce the collar to the dog, and how to start your journey on that. There you go. Betsy, thank you so much for the $1.99. Greg from Do It Yourself Music Biz, buddy, Thank you so much for the $10. Next.
Michael, just wanted to say thank you, Jeff. Thank you for doing this, even though I know you're in pain right now with your broken ribs. Thank you, Linda, for putting up with him. LOL.
So, Michael, thank you so much. They're fractured. Just a little bit of a difference there. Broken, I might not be sitting here. But then again, knowing me, I probably would.
Well, a fracture is a break.
Because I'd be bored off my ass. Okay, whatever. I just don't want to make it seem like it's a, like I said, it's a big deal. I really should. It is, though.
I'm sitting right next to
you. I know, and I can't laugh because it hurts when I laugh.
And I just thought for a second that you had your shirt on backwards and I was going to make fun of you. But no. You're okay.
In fact, I was laughing in the ER. I was making jokes in the ER. They didn't find it funny at all. Mm-mm. It's like, how could you not find this stuff funny?
We always try to say funny things in a bad situation, yes. Especially a medical situation,
right,
where you may not have control over everything, but you can control laughter.
Here's a great example. I have to go get x-rays. Mm-hmm. I shuffle. I do a Mr. Magoo shuffle.
That's what I call it.
The Mr. Magoo shuffle from the bed to the x-ray place. So it's a stand-up x-ray. So I'm there at the stand-up x-ray. And she's like, okay, I need you to put your arms around the machine. So imagine this big, huge box that I'm hugging. And I asked the x-ray tech, I said, can you tell me the machine's name? Because if I'm going to hug this machine, I'd like to know its name. Nothing. Zero. No emotion. I'm like, come on. Let's have some fun with this job. Anyway, let's go. Steve Cooper says 3 millimeter. Thanks, Steve.
Thanks, Doggy Detour, for the $15. Thanks for helping millions of dog owners with your content. I especially like that you demonstrate with untrained dogs so we can actually see how to correct a mistake as it happens.
Yeah. You know, this is the thing. Like we absolutely show before and after videos because we don't do it to show off. We just want people to understand that there's hope, but my audience is dog owners who are struggling. I'm not looking to impress anybody, obviously. I mean, hello, have you seen my appearance? So I'm trying to help you, you know, work your dog. Your dog will make tons of mistakes. We make tons of mistakes every day. Like we're not these, like everything we do isn't perfect. They're dogs. So we absolutely show our work. Next.
Okay. Carol, took Ember to vet for sprained leg. First time since labeled fear aggressive 2 months ago. He sat quietly, allowed muzzle to be put on first time and allowed exam with little struggle. Thank you. Sprain was diagnosis. Sorry for question mark.
Awesome. Cool. So I'm proud of you, proud of the work you're doing. I'm glad that you realize that you can take a dog from one point in life to another point in life. So kudos to you.
Can I just say something?
Sure.
I would appreciate it if you didn't insult your own appearance because it really reflects badly on me.
Well, it takes away your comments then. In other words, I'm taking away your commentary. Is that what you're saying? Why? Because you wouldn't be married to a schlub?
Right.
You're not going to be the first girl from Cranston that was married to a schlub. Join the club. Go. Next.
What abs? Doggy Detour says, good job, Carol.
All right. I love it that everyone's rooting for each other.
Sonia, thanks for all your help and glad I found you when I did. My lab is 2 years, been training him for basic obedience with prong collar, and it works great. My issue is he barks to communicate what he wants.
Okay. So that's a problem. So, I mean, you can tell him to shut up. Teach your dog to stop barking. So your remote collars are great for that. Bark collar is an automatic collar. You know, it goes off when you don't want to. The bottom line is this. You know, I mean, if your dog got to go to the bathroom in the middle of the night and it whined or barked, that's one thing. But for a dog to technically be ringing a bell to call to your attention, no. There'll be none of that. So next.
We have another top chat for $5. Oh, can you check
awesome.
That one out?
I sure can. Top chat is from Ashley. Oh, Ashley, thank you so much, Ashley. Love watching you guys. When using the e-collar, do you still use a low-level stim for punishment, breaking commands, or turn up a few notches? So, no, low-level we do for basic teaching. Guys, the collars were designed to go high for a reason. Punishment should be uncomfortable to the dog. That's the whole idea of punishment. If it's not uncomfortable, it's not considered punishment. If the behavior doesn't stop, you actually didn't properly apply punishment. So you're going to want to go up. How high? The dog will let you know. Next.
Christine, which is best for walking strong, reactive dog, the prong collar or the e-collar?
Well, training is going to be your most effective thing. I want just to start out with that, and I'm not being snarky with you. I would do a prong remote collar combo. The prong collar is good for directional control. It's going to give you a lot more leverage. The remote collar is going to be your final tool that you're going to use to have awesome communication, whether it's close by or far away, that you can whisper or shout with, that is going to be the least impactive on your world, but the most effective on the dog's world. So let's use the combo on that one. And a lot of times, you know, it's like, geez, that dog's got a lot of equipment on it. It sure does. Next.
Sonia says, if I take him off the leash on a trail, he barks at me and will not wander and walk toward forward and sniff. I put the leash back on. All is good. Would love to get rid of the barking to demand stuff. E-collar at max level does not even make him react.
Okay. So if you're using an e-collar at a maximum level, it's probably either a crappy e-collar or it's fit. And I've got a feeling it's probably fit. Now, we only recommend e-collar technology and dog truff for a lot of our training. Now, sport dog runs hot, but to shut the dog up, it's a great collar. Garmin, I like Garmin as a brand, but the handset is a little bit too complicated for me. In fact, I can't do it. I can't dial up and down, you know, quick enough with it. But if you're using one of these cheaper brands, they're pretty crappy out there, so I'd be really, really careful. As far as fit is concerned, you want to make sure that your collar is either on the right side of the dog, the left side of the dog. You want to make sure it's super snug. The collar should not, the box should not be able to turn around the dog's neck. It should be very snug. You want to make sure your contact points are actually making contact. That's why they call them contact points. So they're contacting with the dog's skin. They make thick fur contact points. If you've got a dog with thicker fur, they make short ones. They make long ones. They make sensitive dog ones. They make hyperallergenic ones. So fit is important. But if you're maxing out a dog, unless it's in full drive, and some dogs do blow through them, but chances are it's fit. Next.
Holly. Thanks, Jeff, for being an inspiration for getting shit done despite obstacles, fencing, broken ribs. Hope this doesn't make you laugh. Please take care of yourself. Don't wear Linda out too much.
There'll be no wearing out tonight, if you know what I mean. Next.
Had great existence social intro with my two, this is still Holly, two huskies and new training dog. They didn't even care about each other. How many more should we do before allowing play?
Let's see. Those are your two personal dogs. So for your two personal dogs, let's go a little bit more. Let's make sure they've got a good on-off switch. Let's make sure what we can do is I would, if you want them to play, let's see how if it organically happens. And then also do a little bit and wait. Don't wait until they're overly excited, overly aroused, and then just be like, okay, guys, knock it off. And then let's move on and do something else. So what I don't want you to do is knock it off, end the session and leave. Just be like, knock it off, go back to walking around, and then be like, okay, you guys can go play again, right? So let's put an on-off switch a couple of times into that dog session. Awesome. Next. Congratulations, Holly.
Next one is from, I think it's the Kate. Hey. Thank you, Jeff, Linda, and Joelle for all of your amazing help.
The Kate, thank you for consuming the content. Guys, you know, first of all, I appreciate all the kudos, but the real kudos go to you. Bottom line is this. The kudos go to you. You're the ones that are watching the content. You're the ones that are applying the content. You're the ones that are busting your ass. You're the ones that are getting the results. So I am extremely, extremely proud of you. And for all the folks that showed up in Providence, we had a sold out seminar in Providence, Rhode Island this weekend. Photos are starting to dribble up. There'll be a lot of photos. Joelle took 3,500 photos. So we've got a lot of great content out there, but kudos to you. But thank you so much for being with the kind words. Next.
The next one's from Ms. Tin.
Hey, Ms. Tin.
I saw your video on stopping puppy biting. It worked. Can I put my 8-week-old dachshund puppy on a treadmill? If yes, what's the duration?
I would not. I wouldn't put your 8-week-old puppy on the treadmill. Okay, hold on here. Let me refrain from saying that. What I want you to do with your 8-week-old puppy on the treadmill, spread kibble on it. Let it eat kibble off the treadmill. I want you to use the treadmill for place. Tell the dog to get up on the treadmill, sit on the treadmill. I don't want your dog walking on the treadmill right now. Now, what you can do is you can have that treadmill on so it hears it, just so it starts getting used to it. Next.
Christine. Hi, Jeff. I was at your T3 in Providence this summer. I'm having trouble with my dog and the e-collar. And then Oh, I know she feels it because I can see her muscles contract, but she won't respond to it at all. I have been using it with the prong collar, but stopped because I felt like she wasn't making a connection.
Okay. So what you need is you need a little bit of a refresher. You should probably do a Skype session. Just keep in mind, you know, keep in mind, Christine, that the collar, all it is a machine, technically. Got it? So my laptop here, it does have some really cool software in it. But if I don't know how to use it, to me, I'm gonna be like, big deal. I got software. Somebody else can do wonderful things with my with this computer that I've got in front of me. So remember, what I would do is I would start from scratch. You can use food, the prong, and the remote. Remember, the remote collar though, you still got to train the dog. So we always do a remote collar food combo. Start out with a place command. It's an in movement command. It's in motion. You can use your marker words. You can use a food reward. You can use the pressure on, pressure off of the remote. So, but if you want to be specific, just jump on to my Patreon channel and ask a question, or let's line up a Skype. Next.
Susan says, hi, Jeff and Linda.
Hey, Susan.
Bushcraft says, hey guys.
Hey, what's going on, Bushcraft?
Oh, and Susan says, and Joelle soon.
Yes.
Crystal says, hi, Jeff and Linda. Keith says, Jeff, I'm so sorry to hear you got injured.
Yeah, I know. Thank you so much. Injuries suck.
The Kate, just starting in bite work with 2-year-old Kane Corso. When working on out command with tug at home, how many times do I give the command before I correct?
Well, you know, I would talk to your bite work trainer about that one. I want it the first time. Remember, the more your dog's in drive, the harder it's going to be. You also, if you're going to be doing it, I don't do bite work professionally at all. For me, it's just a little bit of a hobby for my dogs, but you're going to want to make sure the dog isn't mouthing as well. You're going to want a nice clean out. So out is going to be literally tug, 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 out, boom, the dog comes right off. If you're going to be competing, there's probably going to be, you know, points in that as well. I don't know anything about that world. I personally want my outs to be nice and clean. But if you're just a regular basic family pet dog, if you're going to say out once or twice, it's not the worst thing in the world. But let's strive for the first time. Next.
This one's from Russ.
Hey, Russ. Glad you made it back to safe.
Jeff, thank you for being such a huge inspiration to me and so many. It's amazing how you continue getting shit done regardless of what you're going through. Hope you get well soon. Feel good.
Hey, Russ, man, you're the one putting out freaking videos every day. You're kicking my ass on that department, buddy. So I'm proud of you. Next.
Bushcraft. Dog chased a rabbit today. Didn't listen to me to come back. Has done it with dogs in the past. Any tips, Jeff?
So what I want you to do is this. You need to do long line recall work around high levels of distraction with a remote collar. So, you know, you have to remember, the reason why we train the way we train is literally for rabbits, deer, high prey drive stuff. You know, it gives you a false sense of security that your dog recalls in a sterile environment. That's why we need your dog to go up to the punishment level on the remote. What I mean by that is it's easy to get a dog to recall to you when there's no distractions, but if it's not paying attention to you and you have to dial up on your remote, and if you're not using a remote collar at all, I'd suggest doing remote collar training for recall, especially if you, because that's going to be a game changer for you. So remote collar recall for your dog, get up to punishment level. What I mean by get up to punishment level is get up to a level with your dog that the dog, if it doesn't listen, it gets a high level correction, but then it doesn't go away from you to get away from the stim. It comes back to you, and you want to make sure you do that in an enclosed fenced in area on a long line so you can give your dog some guidance. Next.
Mary, how do you teach calmness in the crate? Do you tell a dog to put its head down and correct for any nonsense?
Number two, we correct for any nonsense. We correct for arousal. So I don't like, when I tell a dog to kennel up, it's go in your kennel, lie down, and be calm. Anything other than that would get a punishment. So a dog shouldn't be sitting up. Dog shouldn't be standing up. Dog shouldn't be, you know, I mean, if a dog has to rearrange itself once in a while, it's not the worst thing in the world. But I want the crate to be an obedience command. It's not just a place you go because I'm leaving the house, even though that is what we use the crate for. I don't use crates for punishment. I also don't do timeouts with dogs. It's not bad dog, go in your crate. It's like, go in your crate, time for bed. Go in your crate, I'm leaving. Go in your crate, contractors are coming over. So I want crate to be a part of a dog's life. A lot of times people won't punish in the crate because they're like, oh, then the dog will make a negative association with the crate. The biggest bunch of bullshit I've ever heard in my life. We do it all the time. And we, for some reason, thousands of dogs, we just aren't seeing that. Next.
Next one's from Beverly. Picked up shelter dog today and was told she was extreme puller. Put a prong on her, told her I was Jeff Gellman, and she walked like a princess.
That's good. That always works great. So Beverly, all dogs are extreme pullers until you train them not to be. And it usually takes 2 minutes.
Janice. Good one. What do you think about papillons?
Janice, what's the correct answer? What would you like me to say, Janice? Welcome to my show, by the way. I know I'm being a jerk. What do I think about Malinois, Papillons, Rottweilers, German Shepherds, Shih Tzus? They're fine. They're all fine. I could say they're a pain in the ass or I love them dearly. So, I mean, they're dogs. They're wonderful dogs. If you ask me about what do you think about Malinois, I would say most people shouldn't own one. If you said, what do you think about a bulldog? I said, if you're planning on going on 10-mile hikes, please don't get one. But Papillons are fine dogs. Small breed dogs are fine dogs. The biggest issue is train your dog. I'm a dog trainer. I'm not a breed specific dog trainer. I'm just a dog trainer. I want your Papillon to be a wonderful pet for you. I want your Papillon, if you have a Papillon, I want it to be a wonderful member of the community. And I want you to be able to do awesome stuff with your Papillon. And I don't want that dog to limit your life. That's all that matters to me. Next.
Deborah.
Hey, Deborah.
Hi, Jeff. Hope you feel better soon. I used your methods on my 2-year-old lab mix, Lucy. I got her from a shelter in February, and she is already in her advanced class to become my service dog.
Congratulations, Debbie. Kudos to you again for doing the hard work. Mm-hmm. By the way, everybody that's listening to me on SoundCloud, Spotify, iTunes, this is in no order, okay? Google, iHeartRadio, and there's a bunch of other platforms that stream my stuff, and I'm available on all those podcasts, obviously on YouTube Live, and you're watching on Facebook as well. I'm madly in love with you, and I truly, truly appreciate that you're paying attention to the content. Next.
This one's from Liz. Is leash pop on slightly stubborn 18-week Malinois with prong collar too soon on punishment? Softy me with puppies.
So first of all, Liz, I'm hoping you've got a dog trainer that you're working with because everybody that owns a Mal should definitely have professional guidance. The bottom line is this. It all depends on, first of all, if you're soft with puppies, let's make sure that switches around really quick with a Malinois. That doesn't mean you need to be harsh with your dog. There's a big difference. But proper leadership, guidance, consequences, rules, and boundaries are going to be extremely important, especially with a Mal. So all depends on what your dog is doing. But with all of our puppies, and at 18 weeks, you're at about 4.5 months old, leading into 5 months, you know, with I'm going to have some pretty high expectations of that dog. So we're still doing all food training. We're doing all of our marker training, but we're probably starting to apply some punishers for noncompliance if we've been working on the obedience for a little bit. For any of the stuff that's bad behavior, we're absolutely using punishments, jumping up, using his mouth inappropriately, whining and barking inappropriately. Definitely going to use some punishment on that. Next.
Deanne.
Hey, Deanne.
Thank you for your time, Jeff. How do you teach young puppies to play politely with other dogs? My puppy likes to jump on other dogs while playing, and they understandably don't like that generally.
So if those are other adult dogs, you got to find yourself a dog. I had a dog named Uma who's not with me anymore. She died a couple years ago. Boy, was she a great puppy raiser. Bottom line is a dog got snarky with her. She gave that dog a quick bite. That puppy ran away. But guess what? It came back a couple of minutes later and she was like, we cool now? So you sort of have to do that. So if you don't have an adult dog that's doing that, you've got to do that. So what do? You can use a pet convincer, which is compressed air, pet corrector, pet convincer, compressed air. You can actually use a bonker on a dog. The problem is you'll probably nail the other dog. You can actually just take your little finger, walk up to that dog, give it a little bit of a finger poke. You can do things like that. Also, keep it on a long line. If you want to keep it on a long line, you can give a gentle tug off the dog as well. Next.
This one's from Lisa.
Hey, Lisa.
My 10-month-old golden retriever still pulls on Springer prong. She blows through e-collar, leash reactive, not mean, but excited and happy.
So Lisa, then you're doing it wrong. And I'm not saying that because you're a bad person or you're, what I'm saying is, the tools work with the training. Got it? It's most likely a timing issue. What you don't do is put a tool on a dog. I can train a dog with a shoestring in a slip lead and a treat pouch. Big deal. I'm a dog trainer. I choose not to, though, because I want to train. I want to make things easier for me, easier for families. So what it is it's most likely a timing issue. You're probably waiting until the dog starts pulling to give it information. Everything needs to be done. All the training, all the conversation gets done prior to the dog displaying the unwanted behavior. So you're probably being more reactive than proactive. There's an art to it. It's not difficult to do. People do it all the time. Number one, fit of the tools is number important. Number two, making sure the dog is conditioned to those tools is important, which only takes a few minutes to a few hours. And then also understanding the training on how you want to be doing it. So what I would do is I'd make sure that in your front yard, in your backyard, in your house, the dog understands how a prong collar works. I would work on proper leash handling skills for yourself. I would make sure that your body's in the right position, that you understand, you know, what you're supposed to be doing. I would keep any chit chat to a minimum. And then also, what's the rest of your day look like when you're not out on a walk? Is there too much affection? Is there too much freedom? Is there not enough boundaries? Do you have enough structure in your dog's life? So, you know, does your dog know any of the other basic commands yet, like place and down? Those are really, really important. Kennel up on command. But the tools will work. We've yet to meet a dog that the training couldn't work on. So it's probably a timing issue. Next.
Hey, Melissa, how's it going?
Hey, Melissa, thanks for being here.
Susan, I'm dipping my toes in the water of board and train by working with my brother's dog next month. How much of his time a day should I be training and how much should he be crated?
So your average board and train dog on our property is probably in a crate for at least half the day. You know what I mean? So they only need 90 minutes a day of active training, a couple of 30-minute walks, and then they do a shitload of duration work. Like my dog, I got three dogs next to me right now doing, you know, they're lying down in place. That's training. So you're anytime you're going to be preparing, eating, cleaning up your family meals, anytime you're doing social media, anytime you're watching TV, anytime you're reading a book, if you're working from home, your dog should be in place anywhere from 2 feet to 10 feet away from you. So theoretically, you're training 24 hours a day. Even when dogs are in crates, this weekend seminar, there was 18 dogs there. We had all of them in crates, quiet. Every single dog, leash reactive, human aggressive, dog aggressive, out of control, all in crates, quiet by lunchtime of the first day. That's training. So training is always. Next.
Spinisper, for two dogs, do you prefer a 300 for each or the 302 for both?
You can get the 302 and you can also get multiple handsets if you want to. Get the 302. It'll make your life a lot easier. And it was great to see you this weekend. Next.
Xavier, how do you fit the e-collar when you have the prong on?
Xavier, the prong collar goes up high, remote collar goes below it because the prong collar is going to give you the most directional control. Next.
Lisa says, thanks for doing these vids. You are helping so many people and saving lives.
Lisa, thank you so much for recognizing that.
Wild West Cowgirl. Hi, guys. 1-year-old Great Dane. We are her fourth family, and when we got her, she wasn't trained. Well, she's much better trained now, thanks to you guys. But she power struggles after 10 minutes of training.
So power struggles as in, I don't understand what that term means. Power struggles. You mean she's pooped after 10 minutes or she doesn't want to pay attention to the training after 10 minutes. Help me out. But number one, kudos to you. So the reason why, I mean, I can't imagine an untrained Great Dane. I see them all the time, but I mean, again, kudos to you. And all it takes is somebody to actually dedicate to it, but get back to me on what power struggles means. Next.
Marianne. Hi, Jeff. What cities in New Jersey are you coming? I love the idea of intense one-day training. What can be done and how many hours? Thank you and feel better.
This is a private client in a city in New Jersey. I'm working with three private clients. But, you know, I mean, I'm for hire. It's not cheap. I'm for hire. The cheapest way to hire me is go to one of my seminars. And then the next one after that is to do a one-on-one sessions. But that's only for select clients, because the dog has to have certain behaviors. If your dog's behavior is out of control, one-on-one might not be the best thing for you. But in one day of training, we can accomplish a ton. We can accomplish a ton. More than you've probably been able to do in the life of the dog, unless you're like got some mad dog skills. So we can do a lot in one day. And what you can do is you can just email me, go to solidcaninetraining.com, fill out a contact form, and I can get back to you. But, you know, for me to go to this city, the reason why I was going there, I had to cancel it because I got, it was in the emergency room. I'm going to be rescheduling it, but it was on my way to Elkhart, Indiana, but now I'm obviously committed to it. So I'll be going there separately, either on the way back next week, or I'm going to make a separate trip the following week. So, you know, reach out to me. I might be able to pair up, a city, you know, that I'm going to. Next.
Honey, we just got another top chat.
Oh, we did.
Look at that. $20.
Justin. Hey, man. Thanks, Justin. Can you see that question? Mm-hmm. I'll read it. Okay.
Yeah,
German short hair pointer lab mix named Tahoe. Tahoe doesn't get along with other dogs. He pauses, gets tall and alert, and has very low growl around most new dogs he meets. He's 1.5 years old. We're using a prong in the dog arc. Okay. So, Justin, thank you so much for the $20. This is the thing, Justin. First of all, there's a lot of variables there, buddy. A ton of variables. So I personally don't have my dogs meet unknown dogs. Don't have them meet unknown dogs. We can make dramatic improvement with your dog, but other dogs, I've got no idea what's happening with them. So, but as far as applying your punisher, and as far as starting to go down the road of success, I want you to start focusing on it, the first signs of arousal. So dogs should be on a leash. You shouldn't have dogs meet on a leash, but let's get the dogs to exist around other dogs for right now. I don't want you to go to dog parks, but what you can start doing is you find some dogs that you know personally that you can actually control the humans and give them information as well, and they have control over their dogs. And as soon as that dog starts, what you described is gets tall and alert, boom, that's when you use your remote collar to eliminate the arousal. Now, how high do you use it? High enough to get that dog to go, oh, shoot, I shouldn't have done that. Sorry about that, Dad. I didn't mean to get aroused right now. But then you have to advocate for the dog. So worst thing to be doing is this. Give that dog that information, and then the other dog attacks your dog or jumps on your dog. You just told your dog to knock it off, and meanwhile, the other dog goes, boom. That's why your dog was probably alerting. Now, that's why we don't want to use unknown dogs. Because if we were using a known dog and that dog did that, I would either correct that dog or I'd have the owner correct that dog. But the theory is what we put into practice on a daily basis, we rehab dog killers on our property successfully. And what we want to do is eliminate the first signs of arousal. When I use the word arousal, that could be, you can call it excitement. You can call it, you know, the beginning of aggression. You can call it the beginning of naughty thoughts. That's when we tell that dog, cut it out. The remote collar is fantastic for that. So start doing that. At the same time you eliminate the arousal, what you can also do is your dog's on a leash, you gently guide your dog away. So it's like saying, knock it off, walk away. We're not redirecting. We're walking away. We're teaching our dog how to remove pressure other than getting bigger and growling. Dogs growl to remove dogs from their space. That's why they do it. Cool. Thank you for the question, Justin.
This one is from M. Cunningham. My wonderful goofy dog can't stay still. He can sit down, stay, but he is so over hyper and moves all the time. I have tried collar, but isn't effective. Is there a collar that works for dogs like him?
Well, it's more than the collar. It's the training. You need to learn how to eliminate arousal in a split second. So believe it or not, if I had a dog, I got goofy dogs too. So I got dogs that are high drive. I've got dogs that get excited. I got dogs that love to do stuff. I got dogs that love to work. They love to have fun. They do trick training. They go swimming. But I don't want craziness. I don't want my dogs to be going crazy. So I want controlled chaos if there's going to be chaos. So if what you need to do is you need to eliminate your arousal. So a bonker is a wonderful thing to do for that. A bonker is a wrapped up towel. We use bonkers a lot. And I understand a lot of people struggle with this concept, but it is just a wrapped up towel. That's all it is. So say your dog is all getting all goofy. Believe it or not, you would say no and then bonk the dog. Now, a lot of folks or even yourself might say, oh, but then I'm going to feel bad because he was having fun. No, it's not about him having fun. It's about you learning how to eliminate arousal. Now, that doesn't mean he can't have fun any other time, but it's no different than Angelo. I'll humanize the shit out of this all day long, guys. Okay, I got 7 kids. I work with children. I work with families. You want to play the humanization game? I will play it. Would I bonk Angelo? No, I wouldn't. But if he's at a playground, let him be running. He can't be disrespectful. He can't be loud, but he can run around and play. In a restaurant? Absolutely not. Does that make sense? In karate, he better listen to his teacher. In ballet, he better listen to his teacher. At the playground, in the swimming pool, a little bit more high activity. So he needs to learn what is situationally appropriate for what energies. So does your dog. Next.
Greg says, that's odd. Healthcare workers generally have a really sick sense of humor.
You'd think so. Mm-hmm. Greg, it's not like I asked her to be like, oh, are you going to be doing like, you know, a penile x-ray on me? Like there was no flirting. There was no nothing. She was a younger woman too. It's like, the bottom line is this. And I'm like, man, the first thing I thought of was, man, you must hate your job. Let's have some fun here. I mean, it's a rough hospital. So the really nice hospital that we went to, there was a 3-hour wait. And I'm like, I'll tell you what, let's go to our last choice hospital. How bad could they mess me up? Like, it ain't surgery we're doing here. And we went there. It was a 20-minute wait. It was fantastic. It was fantastic. Next.
Crystal, 130-pound, 1-year-old Noof. I have been trying to work on jumping, been using a prong collar, but he doesn't jump when it's on. But when I take it off, he's jumping. What do I do? E-collar is in the mail.
You're going to, God darn you. There's somebody that came in our front yard, and it's nighttime. He needs to have a bar collar on. Yep. Next. So what I want you to do is you're going to be using a remote collar, and you're going to be punishing. The bottom line is if you use a strong enough punisher, if you do a strong enough punt, knock it off, guys. If you use a strong enough punisher right from the beginning, he won't be jumping on anybody. All right, next.
Monoxide.
Knock it off.
I'm still having some issues with my 4-month-old Rottweiler biting while we play with her toys. I made a bonker and hit hard on her side, but she comes back biting at it. At this point, I stop playing.
You got to tell him to shut up.
I was trying.
No, you have to tell him, name of dog, shut up.
Shut up.
Yeah. Knock it off. It's okay. We'll have a bark collar on him next time. Yep. So what I want you to do is you got a 4-month-old dog. You got a 16-week-old puppy. He thinks probably, or she thinks, it's just a big game. Everything's a big game for your dog. So don't hit the dog on the side. It's no. First of all, if you're on the floor with a dog and you're trying to punish that dog, the dogs will probably think it's play. What? Yes. So what you're going to do is I want you to say no and bonk. It should hit the dog in the head. But also, 16-week-old dog, if it's nipping, take your thumb, take your fingers, take your whole damn hand, put it in the dog's mouth. Next.
Is that another top chat up there or is that the same?
Same one.
Okay, just making sure.
Yep.
Regal Mommy says, LOL, I'm a medic and an ER nurse. I totally agree. You need to laugh in those situations. Fractured, broken ribs are painful. I've been there, slipped on ice. What did you do? Sorry, dude.
You got to watch my Instagram stories. I tripped over a fence. You know how I play railroad track fetch all the time? I climb over this fence. It's a little bit lower than waist high. Every freaking day I climb over this fence. And I climbed over it, caught my foot, landed on my back on concrete. And nothing held me up except for my ribs that were complete. Next.
Okay. Horse crazy. Thanks for the advice about the bonkers. It has helped calm down the barking, but I made smaller ones. LOL, getting prong collared this week and fracture and break are the same thing. Fracture is not as bad as a break.
That's why. So horse crazy. That's why it's a fracture. We want to play this thing up big. Yes.
I'm playing it up.
Yes. Ashley, we already said kudos to her. $5. Thank you. We already answered the question. Next.
Maya. Hi, Jeff. I messaged you the other day to ask, how do you get a dog to stop peeing when they are excited, anxious to greet people?
Where are we here, Jeff? So this is what I want you to do. First of all, don't let the dog greet people for now. So this is what we do with excitement pee. We don't address excitement pee, nervous pee, fearful pee directly at all. We don't address it at all. What we do is it's a board and trained dog. We put them through our full program. We do our program of creating calmness in the dog. What we do is we don't have them greet people. We have that dog learn to do calm things, calm behavior. That doesn't mean it can't go out for a walk. It doesn't mean it can't play chuck it. That means you can't take it swimming. It doesn't mean you can't run around. But what we do is we have that dog, what we do is we have that dog go into our full program, which is a family pet dog program of rehab and training. And that dog learns all its basic commands, but it learns how to do like a lot of duration work, which is calm. For now, if somebody walks in the house, it shouldn't be meeting people. When you walk in the house, it should be nice and calm. You've got to keep that dog calm. You do that for 2, 3, 4 weeks. Next thing you know, you can start bringing back things. But be really, really careful. It's going to be harder for you. But remember why it's excited. Now, if it gets excited, doesn't get excited when it gets excited with you, but excited with other people, you still got to cut that out. It's not forever. It's just during the training process, you've got to create new muscle memory in the dog. Next.
Next one's from Carol. Linda, we do the best we can, but our men look how they look regardless. You're doing a great job with Jeff. LOL. Thank you, Carol. I appreciate those kind words.
Next.
Little Mama Mud.
Yep.
Love your show. Watch it with my kids. Dog will stop his reactivity with a correction, but will grind his teeth till they bleed instead. He went from flail roll to this. He's in a muzzle for my safety.
Yeah. So a lot of dogs grind their teeth. What that is, the dog is still aroused. The dog is still aroused. You actually can correct that with a remote collar. A lot of dogs will chatter their teeth. They'll chatter their teeth. I'm rolling their teeth. I haven't heard that as much, but that's probably what it is. It's still a lot of arousal and stress. You need to eliminate the arousal and you need to eliminate the stress in that dog. And you can do that with a remote collar, believe it or not. You can stop it with a remote collar. Next.
Ashley says, thanks, guys. Love you both.
Thank you.
Love you too. Melissa, thanks. She just put up your rvdogtrainer.com.
Awesome.
Link.
Thank you, Melissa.
MSoul. Hi, per your instructions, my dog is not jumping on me when she brings tug back. Pet convincer works. Also learned out to release tug. Thank you. I am too old to have dog jumping.
Not even too old, too young. Anybody, no dog should be jumping on anybody. Next.
We got a $9.99 chat.
Oh, shoot. $9.99 chat, not shoot. Oh, that's great. It's fantastic. I missed it though. Let's see. M. Cunningham. Thanks, Jeff. I'm going to try the bonker. I use spray bottle, but think the bonker may work better. And I'm old school when it comes to respect. Good to hear someone else say that. Yeah. I'm actually not against a spray bottle. I don't use them. I'm not a fan of them. I'm not a fan of a spray bottle. But a bonker is way more effective. It really, really is. Next. And people are like, well, spray bottle, that seems nicer. Bonker, that seems mean. But technically, if you use a spray bottle and a dog stops the behavior, it's just as mean if you want to consider punishment mean, which I don't. So we have to have different perceptions. I see sushi and I'm like, that's some damn good looking food. Someone else sees sushi and they're like, oh my gosh, I lost my appetite. Same food, different perceptions. Next.
This one's from Melissa.
Hey, Melissa.
Training first client dog, a friend's, for free to gain experience.
Awesome.
Will only have 2 days. Resource guards and has intense prey drive. Have an idea, but want to know how you would maximize the time.
I try to get more than 2 days. Resource guarding, you can stop in 3 seconds with a remote collar. High prey drive, intense prey drive. We don't eliminate dogs' prey drives. We just control it. I would work on all your basic stuff. I would work on all your arousal. I would work on leadership skills. 2 days is not enough time. I mean, I shouldn't say that. My seminars are 2 days long, but I also don't know your skill set. You know, I don't know your skill set. So if it's your first client, I'm gonna consider that you almost have like family pet skill set. Like if you're a dog owner, there's nothing wrong with that. We all started there. So what I would do is I would probably start working on eliminating that dog's arousal, and then start working on, you can do kennel up, thresholds, the walk, sit down, place. Starting to do recall. That's what I would work on. Next.
This one's from Anthony.
Hey, Anthony.
Hey, Jeff, I thought you would be in Florida for the conference. I wasn't able to make it, too busy.
No, I haven't been to that conference for a long time. And frankly, I think a conference in Florida during hurricane season is not the smartest thing. I know they weren't affected at all, but that's not where I was going to be at. So I had a conflict, which was my seminar. Next.
This one's from Jeff.
Hey, Jeff.
Hi, Jeff and Linda. Hope you're feeling better, Jeff. Thinking of switching to raw. Do you use chicken backs as your base protein? Found a great place to get them cheap. What's your raw plan?
No, I use actually mostly ground beef as my foundation. What I would do is this. There's an online, what's the one, that, what's the website?
The Raw Feeding Community on Facebook.
I was thinking of someone else, but the Raw Feeding Community on Facebook. There's a lot of online resources that you can go to. I don't have the skill set to pass on any quality information on that at all. So I would leave that up to the experts. I'm a very green student when it comes to that. Next. But kudos to you for jumping into the raw bandwagon. Actually, I had to take Kira to the emergency room. When was that? Saturday night? Or Friday night? Saturday night? Saturday night? No, Saturday night I had to take her to the emergency room. They're like, what do you feed your dog? I'm like, raw. And she's like, you know, well, what, you know, A lot of shaming, you know, a lot of all this stuff. And I'm like, okay, whatever. Like, tell me what's wrong with my freaking dog. Give me what I need and let me get out of here.
You should have told her the dog was a vegan just to see what would happen.
No. Anyway, next.
Ivana. Hello, our 8-month beagle shepherd gets super excited when I walk through the door, jumps even if I ignore him. When will this stop?
It won't stop at all. You're training your dog to jump. This concept, Ivana, of ignoring your dog, remember, the lack of no is always yes. The lack of no is always yes. Got it? If I grab Linda's boob right now, which I won't do because we'd have to charge admission for this show, and she didn't, and she ignored it, would I stop doing it? Now, it's not as fun if she participated with the act, but I sure as hell know if she kicked me in the nuts for doing it, I probably would stop. Got it? So what you do, don't ignore. Ignore means yes. Just say no. Get yourself a bonker. You come home. Keep this either in your car or keep this by your front hallway. You come home. Dog runs over to you to jump. You say no. Boom. Bonk the dog. The dog won't hate you. You won't ruin the relationship with the dog. All this bullshit that you hear about is false. What you'll do is you'll actually like your dog more because it'll be more respectful. Dogs don't grow out of jumping on people. Next.
Little mama mud, and he is on remote collar and prong. He also anticipates stim.
I don't remember what that goes back to. Sorry. Next.
Melissa. And should I have my friend introduce prong with prong dance and work the dog until our training next week?
Yeah, you absolutely can. Next.
Renee. Hello guys. My dog is usually okay in the car. No reactivity. However, with a jogger or if a random person comes near, he goes nuts. I have the collar remote handy while driving. High level, correct?
Absolutely. Go with your gut on that one. Next.
Would love to know when, if you're coming to the Redding, California area.
I've got nothing planned. I had actually canceled the last 2 months of my 2018 tour because I have to stay in Providence because there's some stuff going on. I was going to be in Ramona, California. I will be out in LA in February, but that's for another seminar that I do, not for my RV seminar. So nothing planned yet. I've got nothing scheduled for 2019 for the California area, but I will. Next.
This one's from Greg. At what point do you food reward a recovering dog reactive dog? We're slowly getting to a point where Dexter makes good choices without being remote tapped.
You can mark it with good and do a little bit of kibble if you want to. But just remember, Greg, you might not have to at all. The lack of a punisher is a reward enough. But if you want to start doing it, start doing variable rewarding now. See how it goes. As long as you're keeping the good results, I have no problem with that. Next.
Denise just gave us $2.
Oh, thanks, Denise, for the $2. That's nice. By the way, this money doesn't get spent on random things. It gets spent on a date night. Mm-hmm. It gets spent on date night. So this week, we won't have time for a date night because mm-hmm. I'm traveling. But don't worry. We'll archive that money for the following week. Or I'll tell you what. I might use some of it because Joelle's going on the road with me. Maybe I'll use it some of it for like on the road stuff.
Maybe I'll slap you.
Okay. So it looks like I've got to use my own funds, Joelle. Okay. So I have to use company money instead of that. So she does 30% of the show. Next.
Sonia.
Thanks.
Thanks. Do you think you will be back in Northeast Canada in Quebec? FYI, I agree with Linda. Stop talking negatively about your appearance. LOL.
Sonia, I will be in Collingwood, Canada in maybe June. You have to look at my, I forgot what month that is. Go to rvdogtrainer.com.
And she just gave us $279 Canadian
money. Thank you very much. Love that, Sonia. Next.
Christine, thanks, Jeff. I'd love to do a Skype.
Yeah, there's a fee for Skype, but this is what I would suggest you do. Join my Patreon page. Go to patreon.com/solidcaninetraining.
Melissa just put a link up.
Join my Patreon page. That's going to be the best way, the least expensive way to get one-on-one time. So many of these questions need like an hour answer. So on the show, you sort of get like a little, you know, the content, the answers are good. The answers are real. The answers work. But you can tell the flavor of the show has got a lot of humor and sarcasm to it. Obviously, sexual innuendos. And but Patreon, that's some pretty serious stuff that we do over there. Next.
M. Soul, is break used just for release? I thought you said to also use break instead of saying stay. Can you go over when to use break and anything else not to use like stay?
No. Stay is implied. Break literally means you're done. It's the opposite of stay. Break is the opposite of stay. So right now, if my dogs are all lying down next to me, if I was to get up, they shouldn't move. If they do, I would say no. And if I want them to like move, I would say break, or I would probably say let's go. Next.
This one's from Private. What level do you use for corrections on the educator e-collar? 20s, 30s, or higher? Depends on the dog, I guess, but I'd like to hear what you say.
I mean, it all depends on, that's a really vague question. I've used all of those things. I mean, it all depends. If 20 means enough to the dog, I use 20. I never know what number I'm going to use on a dog other than active God stuff, which would be the highest level. Poop eating, fence fighting, getting on counters, getting in the trash. Those are all like the extremely high levels for that. But as far as what level would I use it for obedience, for breaking an unwanted command, whatever is valuable to the dog. I never focus on the number. I always pay attention to the dog. But your average collar has either 100 or 127 numbers. They're all there to be used for a reason. So you can have a dog whose working level is 3 that 15 rocks its world. I'm respectful for the dog. So it doesn't go by breed of dog. It goes by what's valuable to the dog. It's all about what's valuable to the dog. Same with rewards. What rewards do you use? Some dogs aren't food motivated, so we don't use any. We can't use any food rewards. So I use all the different numbers. To say that I would use 50 when 15 would work, that doesn't make sense. So, but if you want to know, like, do I go high on a remote? Absolutely, I go high. Do I go 100 on a remote? Absolutely, yes, I do. But not for breaking a command. There's no need to. That's more for like active God stuff. Next.
Next one's from Mike. Hope your rib feels better, Jeff.
Yeah, no shit. Me too. Thanks, Mike.
Bushcraft. I think e-collars are not allowed in Scotland anymore. We'll totally not get one though. Thanks for your help.
So Bushcraft, they are. But if you're opposed to that, that's fine. That's fine. There's other ways to do it. But a remote collar, the reason why you might not want to get a remote collar is because you think it hurts the dog. And the last thing I want to do is hurt a dog. So we're on the same page with that. That's why people don't want to. The bottom line is the reason why people don't want to use remote collars is because they think they're mean and abusive and harmful. That's why. If I thought something was mean and abusive and harmful, I would be against it as well. But I know they're not. So, but if you feel strongly that you don't want to use them, then absolutely do not use one. There's other ways you can punish a dog. You just have to find out what it is. But I'm still looking for that one thing that when my dog is a quarter mile or a half a mile away, I can have a conversation with. That's what I'm waiting for. You know what I mean? That's what I'm waiting for. And it doesn't exist. So remote collars are fantastic, but there's many other ways to use, you know, to use a proper punishment. But to stop an unwanted behavior, you have to use properly applied punishment. It's the only way you'll do it. But I understand people's not liking them. I absolutely understand people's not liking them. Next.
Sarah, sorry you are injured. Jeff, take care of yourself and take those pain meds.
I am.
He's taking them.
Next.
Wendy, hi, Jeff. Our dog has stopped jumping and lunging over the past 5 weeks since using the prong collar. Will we always need to use the prong collar?
So this is the thing, Wendy. You know, do you always have to be on a diet? Do you always have to go to the gym? So my dogs don't jump. I have not had to correct them from jumping I've only owned Tex for a month and a half. I've never had to correct him from jumping. Girl is 8 years old now. I haven't had to correct her from jumping for about 7 years. I've owned Kira for 2 years, 2.5 years. I haven't had to correct her for jumping for about 2 of those years. So, you know, it all depends. It all depends on how powerful of an inhibitor you put on the dog. If your dog is jumping often and you keep correcting it, that means you're actually not properly punishing it. If that makes sense. So what you need to do is you need to make sure you're properly applying a punisher in order to stop a behavior. But the goal is to get off the tools, but you might have to use them again. But not to get off of them permanently, such as if my dog was off leash, I would always have it off leash outside. It's trained on a remote collar. It should always have a remote collar on. God forbid your dog runs into the streets. It's trained on a remote collar, but the distraction is too high. It overpowers you. Then it would be terrible to have your remote collar back at home. But if your dog is still jumping, it's probably a relationship issue and a consistency issue. So next.
Cindy, how do you get a dog to stop licking?
You can use a remote collar for that. You can use a bonker for that. You know, you can do that. So punishment, it's the only way to do it. Now, I understand what a lot of other folks would say. They would say redirect, or they would say teach it to stop licking and then reward. Okay, great. So lick, stop lick, reward. You can even mark it with a clicker. We clicker train dogs, guys. On an average day with 3 trainers at my training center, we reward dogs approximately 1,000 times, 300 times per trainer. That's a lot of kibble. It's a lot of food. That's a lot of food rewarding. That's a lot of yes markers, and that's a lot of clicks. On an average day, we probably punish dogs maybe anywhere from 30 to 50 times. 3 trainers, anywhere from 10 to 15 times per trainer. So statistically, we're at 90-10. That's a pretty good mixture. So I understand the concept of, you know, stopping something and rewarding it, but now you're training your dog a trick. Technically, it's like lick, stop, lick, reward. How about this? Don't lick anymore. I think that's what most people want. Next.
Gonzalo, why do you think most people shouldn't own Malinois?
Just like most people probably shouldn't drive a Ferrari. Do you know what I mean? Because a Malinois is a high drive dog that loves to bite. And most people don't know how to turn that into controlled biting. Most people don't know how to handle a high drive dog. We're getting owners with high drive working labs, and they're going through 5, 6, 7 homes. And you get the right owner for that lab, it's the best dog ever. A Malinois is a different breed of animal. A properly bred Malinois is a different breed of animal. It does sport work and its protection work for a reason, because of its drive. Most people can't handle your average family pet quality dog, let alone a high drive dog. Next.
Connie. No. Sonia. What do you prevent a dog from digging holes in the yard? What do you do? I heard putting their poop in the hole.
I've heard that too. And if it worked, first of all, that's disgusting. I don't want my dog digging like through poop. No. Digging. I've heard putting water in there. I've heard a lot of different things. It doesn't work. There's a lot of these things that, and maybe it did work for somebody. Maybe there's somebody sitting out there saying, no, Jeff, I did that. So what did you do? You found a hole, put a bunch of poop in it, and the dog didn't dig in that hole, but did it stop it permanently? Kudos. Then keep doing it. But what I'd rather do is have a remote collar. out the window and I see it starting to dig, I'd give it a proper punisher at a high level. You make it suck to dig. Dogs can destroy thousands of dollars of landscaping in a very short period of time. You can also put, you know, if you've got beautiful beds, that's why a lot of people put underground fencing around their beds and they put the little flags up. But that's how you stop digging, through punishment. You make digging suck. It's as simple as that. Next. Why do dogs dig? Because it's fun. Next.
Connie, even though you have years of experience, but people want proof of certification or licensing, what do you say?
Nobody has ever asked me that. Nobody. The only people that ever ask me that are other dog trainers that want to shame me. That's it. I've trained over 4,000 clients. I have not once been asked for that. The only people that have ever asked me for that is somebody that is a troll or a hit. I'm not calling you a troll, is a hater. That's it. And I ban and delete haters. I don't get into discussions. And sure, I could take a test tomorrow. I can take a test tomorrow. That's the thing is, it's so funny that if I took a test tomorrow, which I could do, I would have to lie on it because I don't agree with all the correct answers. And I got my certificate. Am I now a better dog trainer because of it? No. Certificates don't mean shit. I'm sorry, they don't. When it comes to dog training, they absolutely don't. They're useless pieces of paper. I know many, many, many dog trainers with lots of pieces of paper that can't even walk a dog. Certificates are being passed out like candy. It's a memorization test. It's not based on skill set. It's not based on results. It's not based on actual real-world results with clients. Doesn't mean anything. Doesn't mean anything at all. So to me, but nobody's ever asked me that. If they do, they're the wrong client. So anybody that follows us on social media, they see the work we do. They see the results we get. That's all that matters to them. And that's all that should matter to anybody. Should matter to anybody is skill set. Next.
We're 2 minutes over my contract.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Love you. Thanks.
Me too.
Joelle. Juan Ching Chan, thank you for everything, Jeff. Prong collar has been working great. Learning e-collar now. Baseline is 10 for short contact points. Do you recommend switch to longer contact points, set lower? No. Are you okay?
Yeah.
Okay. No, I mean, longer contact points just make possibly better contact. The only reason why you would need longer contact points is because you've got thicker fur.
Yeah,
you see it? It's because the dog has got thicker fur. They also make a thick fur contact point. Now, the better the contact, it's possible to lower the number, but there's nothing wrong with 10. Guys, these are just numbers. They're just numbers. That's all it is. Next.
Private, love your videos. They've transformed my dog. Still have a few issues I'm dealing with. When I'm training, one of my dogs just drops and does nothing. Should I use the e-collar on a punish level so he responds?
So Private, that's a really good question. So what you can do is this. First of all, I mean, depends on what's going on with your dog, depending on if your dog's exhausted or not. You know what I mean? If your dog's exhausted, be respectful of that. But what you can do is this. If I've got a dog that is a pushy, snotty dog, or even a fearful dog, and this people struggle with the whole fearful punishing fearful dogs. But if we're still working, and I know I haven't overworked my dog, you can always give a little bit of leash pressure and remote pressure. At what level? I think you were the one that asked about the remote level. At the level where that dog goes, up, I think I'll stop objecting to that. Does that make sense? Let me give you an example. When I play railroad track fetch, Ronan, my Turkish Kengel, has a remote collar on. Okay? So when I go back to the RV, I'm sorry, when I go back to the truck, and usually Ronan's the last one in. So Tex, Kira, and Girl, they go in. Got it? So they go in first. There's not much room left for a Turkish Kengel, but there's enough room because they go in there all the time. So you know what Ronan likes to do? He's like a geometry major looking for fucking how is he gonna fit in this damn little puzzle. I'm like Ronan, load up. And you know what he does? He's like, I'm not all that enthusiastic about loading up. You know what I did? I did this 2 days ago. I gave him a remote collar tap. What number? I have no idea what number, but enough for him to go, I better get my ass in the truck. He flew into that truck. Got it? So I could have negotiated with him. I could have bribed him. We could have done anything. Instead, get your butt in the truck. I've got to get to work. You know what? And guess what? Guess what he does now? He goes in the truck. So just use the level that you think is appropriate. But the biggest thing about punishment, Private, don't ever punish out of frustration. That's the number one thing I can share with people. Next.
This is a continuation of Wan Ching Chan, so you answered it. Heather S. took a dog to an event with several dogs and people walking around, compared walking on an easy walk harness versus prong. What a difference. He looked like a well-trained guide dog with a prong. Easy sucked.
So, that's cool. This is the thing, though. I'm proud of you. Number one, I'm not against head harnesses at all. But what I'm against is, if you're thinking that head harnesses are okay and prong collars are bad, then you're a little bit misguided, because a head harness is a punishment tool. It is a punishment tool. A head harness, if you're like, I'll never punish my dog. Well, if you use a head harness, even though it's called a gentle leader or some other brand, that is a punishment tool. So just for full clarification, that's no reason why not to use it, because if it works for you, it works for your dog, it works for your training, please do it. I am open to all training. What I'm not open to is a trainer saying, don't use a remote collar because they're mean and abusive, because that's an unethical lie. Don't use a prong collar because it's mean and abusive. Don't use prong collars and e-collars because you're just instilling fear in the dog. We specialize in fearful dogs, guys. I think most people don't know what a fearful dog is until they see the dogs we work with. We work with some incredibly fearful dogs. Tools were never used on those dogs at all. No tool got that dog to be fearful. So what did? The family that brought him in is very loving, very affectionate, good dog owners, dog's up to date on all its shots, eats a decent diet, has a nice place to live. So all those things created fear, maybe, right? So a little bit of sarcasm there, I know, but I'm saying, so tools don't create fear. Got a couple of super chats there?
Yep. So Justin Clark.
Oh, we already read that one.
Oh, you did?
Yeah, here's two of the new ones. I get them in up at top for some reason.
How do I get to them, though?
The $5 one. Oh, no, I'm sorry. Justin Clark, go ahead. Yep. Yeah. It said $20. Did you click on the $9.99?
No, I don't. Like, it's
there. That's the one. Okay. That's the one, yes.
So Gonzalo Salinas, he says, love my males. Actually had Whitney, same Whitney that is coming to intern with you, work with my four-month-old.
Oh, awesome. I know.
I still don't understand.
Yeah, I know who you are. Kudos. Great little facility you have there. That's awesome. Well, then because you breed them too. You know that most people shouldn't have them. So good. Yeah. Well, and you're different, obviously. A lot of people can't handle a male. Next. And there's a $5 one.
Yes. So that was from Robert Sanderson, donated $5.
Just for the heck of it. Thank you so much, Robert. And speak louder.
Okay. And then we have Justin Clark. So GSV lab mix named Tahoe. Tahoe doesn't get along with other dogs.
We did that one already.
Oh, you did?
Yep. I did that one. Yep. Yep. What happened was, that was donated a long time ago, and now you finally got to the actual question. Gotcha. So that's how cool the super chat is you get first in line next. So we're doing one.
So
after.
We're at Nick Edmondson. Hey Jeff, hope you're feeling okay. Thanks for all the great information.
Oh, thanks Nick. I'm doing okay. I'm managing here. Thanks.
M. Soul, wish I would have come across you 40 years ago. I would have shadowed you and become a dog trainer. You and your family are great and really helping people and dogs.
So M. Soul, number one, it's not too late. I don't care if you're 89 years old, you can still add value to your community and add value to the marketplace. And then for full clarification, I absolutely have a fantastic kick-ass supportive family, but the ones that are doing the dog work are my awesome kick-ass staff, Joelle being one of them. So I got an incredible group of trainers. I got an incredible admin person and office assistant and personal assistant to me. I've got incredible kennel staff. So next, thanks.
Ron, what's up, J and L? It's Ron from the STL. My GSC is adapting to the e-collar fantastically. Thanks to your videos, and I no longer care about the shitting on the sidewalk. Hell, I prefer it.
Ron, Man by my own heart. I love a good sidewalk shitter myself, buddy. Next. And we already did Justin's. Thank you again, Justin, though, for the $20. Next.
Juke 2. Yep. I started doing the prong collar dance to my five-month-old Palm. He goes into a frenzy just to put the prong collar. It's two-man job just to put the collar on. How do I stop this and make him calm?
So believe it or not, Juke, you can punish the dog. And it's a Palm. I know. A Pomeranian. It's a 5 to 8 pound dog, 10 pound dog. You don't have to use a bonker this size. But if your dog is going nuts, first of all, come on. It's a freaking Pomeranian. Two-person job? Give me a break. You're not building a house, okay? You would say no, bonk the dog. And you're like, oh my gosh, I want the walk to be fun. So do I. But guess what? It ain't fun now. It's bullshit. It's manipulative. It's nonsense. If you don't want to do that, you can put a slip lead on the dog first, right? Put a slip lead on the dog and then give the dog a little bit of a leash pop with a slip lead. Tell him to cut it off. Take one of your fingers, poke him in the side. Hey, cut the crap. It's no different than a child you're trying to put on their snowsuit, right? Child, you're trying to put on a snowsuit. The kid wants to, I don't care. Here, there's a good example. The kid wants to play in the snow, or you need to put that snowsuit on because you're going outside and that kid's wiggling around. I'm not going to bonk a child or poke a child, but just going to be like, I'm going to have to communicate with that child in a way that it understands to cut the shit. We have places to go. Next.
Justin Clark says, thank you guys. He's so nice with people. I'm frustrated.
Justin, I want you to know, I know it's frustrating and that's why I do what I do. But keep in mind, we have dog killers. We have dog killers that my kids can, we don't allow my children to hug dogs ever, but my kids could hug them. They can lay down and spoon with them. It's two different species. It's two different species. But I'm telling you though, you can get over this. You can get over this. Next.
Wild West cowgirl, sorry, doesn't want to pay attention anymore, refusing to perform a command, even as simple as a sit. I think because she's never had a leader in her life giving her direction and rules and boundaries.
Oh, then guess what? We call that pushy snotty. Let's work that dog for 5 more minutes. All right? Got it? Work that dog for 5 more minutes. If that's what you're referring to about the dog that just like lays down, I think, and quits, if I recall, let's just do that. It's like, no. The training session is done when I say so. And that's like, oh, so you just like to be dominant with a dog. No, but I don't like dogs being pushy and snotty with me. Or else guess what? Be careful what you wish for. Next. I wasn't talking to you, Wild West. I was talking to the universe that likes to say stuff back. Next. I like to respond to all the questions, even the question behind the question or the answer that I'm giving the side question. Next.
Duly noted.
Yes.
Justin Clark, we put him in a down, usually needs a 25 hit on the e-collar, and then the other dog usually gets aggressive with him.
Yep.
He said, that's crazy helpful. I get it now. Thank you very much.
Yeah. If you're around dogs that are getting aggressive with your dog, wrong dog. Not your dog. Wrong dog to be around. Guys, my dogs don't interact with other dogs. My dogs can be around other dogs. My dogs do not play with other dogs. I don't trust other dogs. Now, in my training center, it's a different story. We do socialization, but I don't trust the public's dogs. No, there's too many variables between the dog and the owner, and then environmentals, way too many variables out there. Next.
Jason Lee just took my GSC swimming for the first time, and he's already fetching balls out of a lake. At what point is too cold to swim your dog?
Nice. Look
also,
at that.
Did you ever tell the story of how you took ownership of Tex?
So Jason, I swim my dogs in the freaking wintertime, and I live in New England. I swim them in the ocean, though. So if you've got a lake and it don't freeze over, you probably can swim that dog. And plus, it's a lab. Labs are made to swim in the winter. For hunting, they swim. Now, just be careful about hypothermia. Make sure you take a good CPR class and learn. But, you know, dogs love to work in the wintertime. As far as Tex is a Malinois I've had now for about a month and a half. Tex, I have shared the story, but I'll share it around now just to bring more awareness to the situation that why he's with us. Tex belonged to a wonderful man named Tim Samuels. And he ironically came from a rich and Marissa, who own a rescue in New York, who actually were at my seminar this weekend. He was adopted from them about a year and a half ago, and he struggled with that dog. So Rich recommended solid canine training for his trainers. So Tim came up from Pennsylvania with his dog. We had that dog into a boarding train. The dog was with us with a boarding train. We rehabbed the dog, trained up the dog. Tim got the dog for about 6-7 months. Tim did a fantastic job with that upkeep and actually even made the dog better than when it left us. Unfortunately, on August 7th of 2018, which was just a couple of months ago or a month ago, Tim committed suicide. So Tim struggled with depression for a long period of time. And on August 7th, it was too much and he took his own life. And so we talk about it openly. His family does as well. I've got permission to talk about it. But depression in mental health are very powerful forces. And then immediately text came to us. He wanted text to come to us. So he came to my facility. He ironically was trained at my facility when I was actually not there. I was traveling last year. So maybe this was about 10 months ago. And so I made sure he was safe around dogs, safe around my kids. And then within about 5 or 6 days, I took ownership of Tex, and he's become part of my pack. And he's actually going on the road with me in the RV. We were supposed to leave tonight, but because of my fractured rib, I won't be driving out until Wednesday night. It won't be healed by then, but hopefully I'll be able to move enough by then. But I'll be documenting all of that, obviously, if you follow me on Instagram stories. If you're not following me on Instagram stories, I encourage everybody to do so because it's a lot of fun. It's a lot of fun. Next.
All right. KSkier22, just curious. I know walking on a leash with your dog is like replicating migrating. So when you're walking around off leash, is this migration too? Should the dog be behind or next to me? It looks like it got cut off.
Okay. So just to let you know, I mean, so yeah, it's up to you. When my dogs are, I don't do off leash healing technically, because if my dogs are off leash, that means we're in an open area. So in an open area, that means that they have more freedom. So technically, when my dogs are off leash, they're playing. They can be ahead of me. They can be behind me. They can be off to the right. They can be off to the left. We're probably doing some activity. Now, when I go back to my truck, like this weekend, we'll do some – this week. Okay, it's got an itch on my nose. Hold on 1 second. This week in the RV, I stop the RV every couple hours and I play chuck it with the dogs. We'll go to a grassy area. And then when we're done, I'll recall my dogs to me and I will off leash heal them back to the RV, or I'll throw little slip leads on them. So, you know, that's up to you. Migration, all migration does is mean movement in my world, movement in a direction with togetherness. Next.
Heather S. Donated $4.99.
Oh, awesome.
And she says, the client thinks easy walk, harness clips on their chest is best for control. I did video showing how much better the dog behaves on prong for corrections.
Awesome.
All right.
Yes. I mean, again, a harness is not designed for obedience training at all. A harness is designed to work. One of my dogs does bite work and tracking, and she wears a harness. Next.
Crystal, thanks for the help.
You're welcome.
Cheryl D., a lot of common sense and a bit of humor. I think there may be hope for us and the dog.
There is.
Kay Skier, here's the rest of her thing. She said, My dog is trained where she can go about 20 feet ahead, but she must periodically be checking in. Is this the correct way to walk off leash, or should she be next to me?
No, that's fine. I'm assuming you're not in the middle of a downtown city center, right? That's fine. You decide. You decide where your buffer zone is. You decide where your buffer zone is. Next.
And I scrolled down too far. Hold on.
Crystal, dog only listens to me. If I leave to put the baby to bed, he's barking and jumping and mouthing the other people in the house. I plan to give e-collar remote to them to punish. Is that all I should do? Crystal, I would have your dog in place. You could do that, but also put your dog in place. It's right after Melissa had a...
Why can I not find this?
I keep scrolling. I'll keep reading them. Don't worry. Put the dog in place. Absolutely. I prefer if other people weren't punishing your dog. Next. Tiffany G., 160-pound border bull
with
dog reactivity issues in the car when a dog and owner approach on a narrow path to pass us. E-collar correction at first sign of arousal. Still exploded. Guess it needed to be higher. Probably needed to be higher. You probably underwhelmed your dog. Next.
Bushcraft Scott, should I say no with prong collar correction when my dog shows arousal towards other dogs on the leash? He sometimes lunges. Thanks, guys.
Bushcraft Scott, yes, you should. Will you always say no? You could say no is a precursor. No is a precursor to a punisher. So it would be no, and then whatever punishment device you decide to use, you would do that to eliminate the arousal. Next.
Ryan, hey guys, how much should you go above working level on the e-collar for a correction, like getting out of place?
Well, Ryan, there's a proper way to punish, and you still have to teach your dog how to punish, what punishment means. The last thing I want anybody to be doing is just pushing a button on a remote without giving enough guidance to your dog when it comes to obedience. So when it comes to obedience, what you want to do is the leash should be on the dog. You still have to teach the dog how to be properly punished, believe it or not, which sounds crazy. It's like, what do you mean how to be properly punished? There is a proper way to reward a dog. There's a proper way to punish a dog. So what I want you to do is if you say no, use the remote. At what level? At a level that makes the dog go, whoa, I guess I shouldn't have broken command. But remember, at the beginning of the punishment sequence, you might have to put the dog back into place because it's not going to know what to do. So you still have to teach the dog what to do after the punisher is delivered. And then eventually, not that long, the dog goes, I got this. I understand this. Next.
Megan, dog fear poops at the sight of people. Been doing tons of training and she's doing a lot better.
Wow.
How will I know she's ready for somewhere like Home Depot to continue public training and socialization?
You get yourself a bunch of bags. You get yourself a bunch of wet wipes. Stick them in your pocket. Go to Home Depot. Give it a shot. Next. I would monitor that dog's food, though. Monitor that dog's water. Make sure you're not overfeeding that food, that dog at all. And don't let people pet that dog. So I would go to Home Depot and just, this is what I would do. Walk down an aisle. Walk back. Go back to the car. Boom. You're all done. Start doing that. Next.
Did you guys read the super chat already?
M. Cunningham?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. The K8, I'm a Patreon member and want to up my membership level to take advantage of the Skype sessions to work on some specific issues. Is it okay to do this on an intermittent basis as issues arise?
Kate, yes. I've got people that are at the $5 level. That maybe 1 month they'll go up to the $50 level, they'll go up to the $100 level, they'll go back down, they do it for 1 month. Patreon allows you to do that. Just make sure you do it in the calendar month. In other words, if you join Patreon, say on the 25th for say $50, and then you don't cancel until say, you don't switch it until say the 15th of the following month, you're gonna be charged for 2 months. I believe that's how Patreon does it. So that's all up to Patreon. So I would read all the rules and stuff. It's not like that I do that. It's like I don't do anything. To me, it's a machine that works on its own, and I just respond to the questions. I don't know how all the payment stuff works. So I just set it all up, and then they control it. So just make sure. All right, next. I don't want you to be overcharged. Next.
Little Mama Mud, thanks, Jeff. We'll stim him for the grinding. He also chews his hair when left alone, practically lives in a muzzle.
Thanks, Jeff. We'll stim him for the grinding. He also chews his hair when left alone. Yeah, your dog is underneath a lot of stress. So your dog is underneath a lot of stress. I would be doing lots of duration work with your dog, more rules, more boundaries, more guidance. Make sure you control that dog's arousal. We're not anti-drug at all, but most dogs have to come, all dogs have to come to us off of drugs. You can also start looking into CBD oil, cannabis oil. I'm not a expert on that at all. There are people out there that are really, really good. There's a lot of different mixtures of it, but you probably want to talk to somebody about that. Clients are giving us some really good feedback on that. Next.
Melissa. Great. That's what I was thinking. They live 2.5 hours away, so I can only spend 2 days with them at a time right now, unfortunately.
I got it, Melissa. Cool.
Crystal, can an e-collar be left on all day? Just rotate every 4 hours?
Let's see. All day as in like 12 to 16 hour day? Yes, you just want to rotate it. If your dog gets... if you ever see any, whatchamacallit, sores, it's from pressure sores, not burning. Next.
Doggy detour. I like the spray bottle for whining in the crate at night in our bedroom. I will also bang on the cage. Both work great when we get a new dog in our rescue.
Doggy detour. Keep doing it. Kudos to you. Absolutely keep doing it then. Next.
Joseph says, you guys are awesome.
Awesome, Joseph. Thank you.
Bushcraft Scott. I have nothing against e-collars as long as they are used correctly.
Bushcraft Scott. I agree. This is the cool thing, Bushcraft Scott. So, number one, well, why wouldn't you use one? You would use it correctly, right? Come on. You would, you're doing the show. You're doing all the right stuff. You're asking all the right questions. Let me just explain from my perspective what I see. I actually did a seminar in Scotland. I actually sat down with Scottish Parliament. You've got a nice little parliament building. I believe it was the Department of Farm Agriculture. I think it was the Department of Agriculture who oversees the dog. It was a gentleman and a woman. We sat down with them and we helped them design. I was against a total, I'm not against regulation of remote collars, but I'm also highly against banning of them. So they're going to come up with regulating. So I actually sat down with them and we went over some stuff. I also feel that they should be made available to anybody that wants to use them, but I believe they should get rid of all the crappy ones. So, but over and over and over again, I meet people. So I'm in the trenches with people. I'm in the trenches. Over and over and over, all I'm seeing people is use them, but use them too low. Too low. In other words, the opposite of overusing them, they're actually underutilizing the remote collar. That's what I keep seeing. And do you know why? Because nobody truly wants to hurt their dog. Now, if somebody wants to hurt their dog, dog abuse is out there. I fully recognize that. I fully recognize that. But if you're going to abuse a dog, you don't need to buy a remote collar to use a dog. Think about it. You don't need to spend $200 to do it. You can do it without any cash outlay whatsoever. So obviously, we want to educate people. But your average person, the problem is you cannot set a training law because of a few people that might break it. You just can't. You just can't. There's always going to be a bad apple out there. There's always going to be a bad apple. So, next.
Bo, did you get your start in dog training by hiring someone to help you with your dog? How soon after did you decide to make a career of it?
Bo, I got my career in dog training about 14 years ago. I've got a dog named Max. I got him. It's my first dog. It's a 5-week-old German Shepherd from a backyard breeder. And its parents were highly aggressive, and I didn't know what the hell I was doing. And I was in the same boat as all of my clients and everybody else. This is before social media, so I didn't have any of the resources at all. I ended up with a dog that was human and dog aggressive, disobedient, wouldn't listen to me, went to numerous different trainers. Nobody can help him. Finally, I did find a trainer who actually doesn't train anymore, who helped me dramatically. And then I just worked with him for maybe half a dozen months. And then I just started busting my butt learning on my own. And then finally, I just started helping other people. And then I've learned what I've learned just through experience. Next.
Karen, hi, Jeff and Linda. Hope your ribs are better. Started the prong and your other techniques and my GSC has improved. Thank you. I owe you $1 million. Starting the e-collar next.
Awesome. Don't owe me anything but those kind words. And you don't even have to give me those kind words. So thank you so much. You did. I appreciate it.
Justin Clark, my other dog is a Malinois, and I'm sure my e-collar has saved his life multiple times. We're outdoors all the time, and he's extremely prey-driven. Big believer in them.
Yep, absolutely. Good job, Justin.
Melissa Harvey, dog inhales kibble at mealtime without chewing. Can that be changed with training?
Yeah, Melissa, it can. What I would do is this. You could actually get yourself a cupcake pan, and you can put the kibble in the cupcake pan. You can actually take a sheet pan, spread the kibble out over a sheet pan. You can actually take the kibble, go outside to a grassy area if you want to, spread it out over the grassy area. You can actually take it. They do make slow feeder bowls. You can do that. There's a couple of different options there. Next. Or you can use food for dog training. We use the dog's daily kibble for training. Next.
Leo to Link. Welcome back, Gellmans. And did you read this one from Gabriel?
From Gabe, nope.
Okay, so Gabriel donated $1.99. He said, what happened to Kira?
Kira just had a good amount of blood coming out of her butt. So I got a little bit concerned. So I wanted to make sure. And I took her to the – normally, I'm not one of these people that rush their dogs to the vet. But there was a good amount of blood coming out of her butt. And this was – I knew I was going to be going on the road. I knew I was going to be going on the road tonight, which I'm not anymore. So I was like, you know what? If I got a problem with my dog – Let me find out now, Saturday night, because I didn't want to wait till Monday, because if there was a major problem and I'd have to have surgery, and I'm not being paranoid, I'm just being practical. I don't want to, you know, have to do it on Monday when I'm not in town. Let's take care of business over the weekend. So I went there and thankfully nothing was wrong at all. But boy, that was an eventful night because a dog died in surgery that night and the family was out of control. And on my way out, a couple came in very distraught and their dog had died at home and they sent a stretcher out for that dog. And obviously it was one vet tech, one stretcher, and then one of the owners, and it was 130-pound Rottweiler. So I gave him a hand bringing that dog in. I was around a lot of different dog stuff. And I was just thinking as I was helping this owner pick up its dog, its family pet that was 10 years old and it died at home. And I helped them bring it in and they were there to cremate the dog. And I was just thinking to myself, does it really matter how they train their dog? Does it really matter how they train that dog? Does it really matter what tools they used? Does it really matter if they were against how I train? Was it matter if they were fans of how I train? The pain they felt that night, they're human beings. That's why people that don't like me, it doesn't bother me. And it amazes me the amount of hate we have in this industry and hate in these folks that they are so mean and rude around an ideology that they forget that 99.9% of dog owners out there really care about their dogs. They're really trying the best for their dogs. They want the best for their dogs. And I find that it's a little bit hypocritical, the amount of heat that we have in this industry based on tools. And I could care less how anybody trains their dog, because I don't discount the love you have for your dog. And I don't think a training tool, what's the word I'm looking for, is your identity as far as the love you have for your dog. So as sad as that was that night, and even after paying the damn emergency vet room bill, that was a good fucking night, man. That was a good night. Next.
Bo, do you prefer a specific type or brand of leash? Any specific characteristics would work better for dog handling?
No, I mean, not Bo. I mean, a well-worn leather leash is something nice. You know what I mean? I personally just use – actually, the reflector ones. Yeah. I just got in these new nylon leashes that have reflective stitching in them, just because Joelle and I go out for walks, and it's getting late out. And the other night, we're walking and I'm like, damn, it's like pitch black out here. My leashes are black. I think your leashes are black. Our dogs are dark colored. We're not wearing any reflective gear. So I said, let me get a bunch of $5 leashes. So I got some nylon leashes with just built-in reflective, you know, thing on it off of Amazon. But I guess you can always put a piece of reflective stuff on your body or also on your dog's cow or something like that. So, but a nice leather leash is nice. 6 foot leash is usually enough. Next.
Life with Doberman. Hi, Jeff. My puppy gets crazy after eating and every day at 7 p.m.
I know. Fuck. 6 to 9, man. 6 to 9. It's the 6 to 9 zoomies. Yeah. So that's just normal shit. Just tell your dog to cut the shit. You know what I mean? So in the house, I don't like it. If you're outside, who cares? But in the house, just tell the dog no. Bonk the dog. No. Correct the dog. So we got $9.99 from Gonzalo. We already read the question. And Robert, $5 from you. Thank you so much, Robert. We already gave him a kudos. We'll give it to him again. Next.
Lucas. Hi. Hello. Luck from Poland.
Hey, Poland. Hey. How are you there?
Robert Sanderson. Hey, Jeff. Love you. Love what you're doing. I've got a 9-month lab. She is great. Getting good results with the ET300. Question. If we train on a level 5, what is a good correction number?
Robert, you know, I've talked about that a couple of times tonight. First of all, thank you so much. Congratulations. Whatever is valuable to the dog also depends what it's doing. I mean, your dog's jumping on the trash can. You want to go up super high. It's not in proportionate. I got a dog getting into my trash can. It's 100. I got a dog getting up on my counters. It's 100. I got a dog eating poop. It's 100. I got a dog getting in the dishwasher. It's 100. Eating litter out of the cat box. It's 100. I want it to suck. Breaking command, though, you're going to have to figure out what's going to be the meaningful level. It's probably not going to be an 8. It's probably going to be, you know, it could be a 15 to 20. But I want you to gauge it from the dog. Use your eyes on the dog, not your eyes on the remote as much. All right? Take note of what it is, but look at the dog. Next.
Leo to Link. Been trying off-leash training my Dobie using your tips with a long leash prong while utilizing the here command. She's catching on quick.
Awesome. Practice, practice, practice around low levels of environmental stimuli. And then eventually you want to add as many higher levels of environmental stimuli as possible. Because why? We live in a really busy world. Next.
Tiffany, I have a super high drive athletic sport Labrador. Everyone tells me to get a Mal for the sport. Give me a break. I don't have the time to commit to a Mal.
It's funny because I was offered a Mal puppy. I mean, I have to pay for it. I was offered a Mal puppy from a really, really great Mal breeder. Cause I met him through some colleagues of mine. He breeds males, he trains males, he competes males. And I'm like, why don't you keep it? And you know what he said to me? What are you freaking nuts? I don't got time for a male right now. Male puppy right now. He just had a new baby. So yeah, it's a lot of work. We just got another super top chat. You see that?
Yep. Awesome. KD, $5.
Awesome. Thank you.
He also says, y'all are beautiful and very informative. Any suggestions on training my golden retriever to run alongside me biking? Much love.
Yeah, believe it or not, I bike with my dogs. I put them on prong collars because it's the safest thing to do. What I would do is make sure you can walk your dog on a prong first so it understands the tool. And then I know they make all kinds of attachments for the bikes. I just put my dog on a leash and it's in my left hand and I bike. So the dog's on my left side usually when I walk and my hands are on my handlebars and I just go. And I usually don't have the dog more than, you know, it's probably like no more than 2 feet away from my bicycle. What you want to do is make sure that dog understands how to walk next to a bike. You can start by walking the bike with the dog next to it so it gets used to the wheels. The last thing you want is a dog getting under the bike, getting ahead of the bike. So heel is heel. I actually tell my dogs to heel when I'm on the bike. Now, if you're doing off-road stuff, you want to do that off leash. And I would remote collar train that dog. And then I would make sure that dog, you got to be super careful about that. Having the dog maybe behind you, in front of you, you got to watch out because if it's a really busy trail. Next.
Leo to Link, when my Dobie was 4 months old, I had a trainer from PetSmart tell me that she was too young for dog training. I had to check her and let her know that if she wanted unruly adult dogs, that was her business.
So that's really interesting coming from a trainer. 8 weeks old, but technically at 1 hour old, you can start training the dog to environmental stimuli, different temperatures, different surfaces. But at 8 weeks old, you should already, by 6 weeks old, you're already starting your crate training. 8 weeks old, you're starting a lot of your puppy training, which is all done with food and markers. So that just shows you, unfortunately, the amount of unethical, ignorant, wrong information there is. I mean, coming from a trainer, no matter where they work, that's just stupidity. Next. And by the way, somebody mentioned about certificates earlier. Remember that? Okay. Big box trainers. And I am not dissing a big box trainer. You're probably helping somebody out there. Those dogs trainers are certified. Got it? Those dog trainers are certified just for informational purposes out there. Next.
Siobhan. Hey, Siobhan. Hi, y'all are gorgeous. Going to train a small dachshund, small neck, going to use a 2.25 prong. What's the minimum amount of prong lengths that will be effective?
Siobhan, by the way, I love you. You're fantastic. I wish we had more of you. And stop wasting all my fucking post-it notes. So this is the thing. You're going to have to do it for the size of the dog's neck. Chances are you're going to be going to the 1.75. And if you don't have any, you can pick some up this weekend. We've got some good quality ones. We've got some that are made in the United States. So I would say if it's a mini dachshund, you know, we're talking about a dachshund that's probably under 10 pounds. There's some fat ass dachshunds out there. But if it's a mini dachshund, you're probably going to want the 1.75, hon. Next.
Okay. Leo to Link says, oops, I was right. Ignore me. And I scrolled down too far. Why does it always do that on here? All right, here we are. Heather S. Did you get her donation earlier?
$4.99. Yeah. Client thinks he's yes. Okay. Yep.
Doggy Detour. Most people who do not like prong collars are usually ones that have never actually used one.
They are, but also keep in mind, Doggy Detour, in my industry, or you're probably seeing the pet industry as well, it's very, very, very well known that a lot of dog trainers out there that are yelling and screaming about positive reinforcement only are going home to their personal dogs and using tools. I know many, many of them who are doing it. I know many of them who the only way they can control their dogs is having a remote collar on them 24/7. And there's nothing wrong with that. I have no problem if somebody needs that tool, but to be that hypocritical, that unethical, and to tell other people that those tools are bad and they should put down their dog. And meanwhile, your dogs are not even underneath voice control and inside your house. Wake up, people, wake up. Always remember, what's someone's agenda? What's someone's agenda? Now, of course, I've got a big ego, but my ego is stroked through helping as many people as possible, not coming across as some smart, intelligent man. It's like, how can I help more people with no obligation of anything in return? But a lot of people are based on ego, on just like pretending they're like the one all be all. I know I don't have all the information. So, but the hypocrisy of trainers out there is disgusting. And that's not just in the positive industry, that's in the balanced industry as well, my world. A lot of dog trainers out there in my world are preaching low level, low level, low level only, never go high. But I know that you're full of shit. And I'm not pointing fingers or I'm not shaming anyone. I'm just saying, please think about the messages. Are you saying things for more social media likes? Are you saying things to build more friends in social media? Are you saying things for that? Because if you are, that's a little bit misguided. We're supposed to be helping people keep their dogs alive. We're supposed to be helping people keep dogs in homes. We're supposed to be ending the suffering of human beings out there who are really, really struggling. Owners are struggling. Everybody thinks I love dogs. Yes, I care about dogs, but I'm madly in love with the human race. I believe we live in a wonderful fucking world. And I am fully aware of the evil out there. I have met that evil. But I believe we live in a wonderful place with wonderful people who want to do better and who want to help people. And I find it extremely, extremely hypocritical out there that people are preaching one thing and practicing another. literally within a 12-hour period. It's disgusting. It's shameful. And I never name names because I find that unprofessional. But I want the consumer to be very, very aware that some of your loudest anti-tool people are going home and using the same tools they shame you for on their own dogs. Now, we as professionals should have a higher skill set, but we should have a higher moral road as well. Next. Sorry.
Megan Reynolds. Thanks, Jeff. I used to take her to public places, but now I think I need to back up, as she would fear poop every time a person came near. She only gets fed once a day, doesn't fear pee that much ever, always poops.
Yeah, so I would get her around as many different environmentals as possible. Just maybe make it short and sweet. Next.
Yeah, she says she will try the small training sessions, like going for a few seconds, then working up.
Sounds great, Megan.
M. Soul, can I have a collar on and an invisible fence collar at the same time? I need to try to keep her from charging the fence, dogs walking by.
Absolutely. Next.
Lil Mama Mud, the teeth grinder is on place for at least 4 hours, then another 4 in the evening, 2-hour walks. He is super dominant. Appreciate your content. Joining Patreon.
Yeah, I'd look into some sort of, you know, CBD oil. Again, I'm not an expert on that. I'm not qualified to talk about it. Other than this, if I was busting my ass, like right now, I've got 3 dogs in place right here, and I'm really good at getting dogs to be calm, and they're high drive dogs. If I was struggling with my guys, the first thing I would do, I mean, not the first thing I would do, is if I knew I was busting my ass, I would look into CBD oil myself. Next.
Crystal, appreciate all the help. Your videos have helped so much in teaching me how to train my dog and to stop him from being an asshole.
Awesome. That's great.
Melissa Harvey says, thank you.
You're welcome.
Heather S., noticing some resource guarding from a family member's dog that I occasionally watch. Taught out, but still reacts from time to time around dogs he used to be great with. Thoughts?
You know, Heather S., all depends. I mean, if your dog all of a sudden is between the ages of 1 and 2 and it's getting a little bit older, there's a lot of factors out there. There's a lot of unknown factors. There could be the energy coming from the other dogs. But the bottom line is this: I feed dogs in crates. So right now, one of my dogs, I've got an outdoor dog, Mac. He lives outside. He eats in his own yard. And then my other 4 dogs, they're lined up in their crates. And I feed them each individually there. They all eat in about 1 minute or less. Then we're done. Food bowls go up. And now and we're done. Actually, I put the food bowls in the sink because I feed raw. Next.
Steinberg 08, thoughts on letting your dog sleep in bed?
So I'm not against dogs sleeping in bed or dogs in the furniture, but what's your dog's behavior? So if you've got a dog that's, you know, resource guards anything, including you, it's leash reactive, separation anxiety, any human or dog aggression whatsoever, pushy or snotty, fear-based, so we're getting close to almost every dog, right? I highly suggest not. If your love and affection on a scale of 1 to 10 is higher than your leadership and guidance and consequences on a scale of 1 to 10, you probably shouldn't. If your leadership, guidance, consequences, and training is pretty damn on par and up high, and as long as your love and affection is below that, you'll be fine. But I'd be super careful. Sleeping in bed with you is the best gift, the best reward that a dog can have. So I would just be careful. So I would need a lot more information, but I just gave you a little bit of information on that. Next.
Miss Tin, how do I teach boundaries to an 8-week-old dachshund puppy? Thanks in advance.
So 8-week-old, the dog don't know much of shit. So pretty much, I'm not sure if you mean by boundaries as in boundaries around your house, around your yard. You should be keeping that dog on a leash, or boundaries about what's right or what's wrong. So with an 8-week-old puppy, we use the dog's daily food and we click or train the dog, or at least we mark or train the dog. And we have that dog work for all of its food. An 8-week-old puppy should be in a crate for about 20 hours a day. Not continuously, but that's 4 hours outside the crate, which is technically 8 30-minute sessions, which is a lot for a dog that young. So that dog comes out of the crate, teach it to wait at the crate, come out of the crate on command, start working that dog. That dog can be worked on all of its basic obedience commands, sit, down, place, tons of recall training. Don't even worry about walking on a leash yet. Dog should probably drag a leash on, at least have some sort of collar, have a little nylon buckle collar on that dog. What you can be doing is make sure that dog isn't jumping, make sure you recall that dog and it always sits in front of you, never jumps up on you. You can eliminate it mouthing on you immediately. You know, a dog, this concept that a dog is going through its teething phase, that's all good, but you don't teethe on me, you don't teethe on my kids, you don't teethe on any of my property. So, you know, as far as boundaries, teaching a dog what's right and wrong starts with dog training. Next.
Russ says, it was worth listening to this whole show to hear you talk about the night at the vet. Some real shit.
Oh, thanks, Russ. Hey, Russ, I got a question for you. Do you wear tank tops in the winter? Next.
I'm curious about that, too.
Yep.
Lexi Rexy 91, my four-month-old male GSD, when excited, bites my clothes and legs. My three-year-old. Is this puppy behavior or behavior issue beginning? How do I make sure he is gentle when playing with my three-year-old?
Whoa. Okay, you got a four-month-old dog. You stop that tonight. Number one, you've got a toddler and a 16-week-old dog, German Shepherd dog. You need to have extreme training on both. On both. You need to stop that now or that dog won't make it to 6 months old, I assure you. And a lot of people are like, oh, I would never give up my dog. Yeah, you would. That dog injures your toddler. You're going to have to give up that dog. All right. So, and if you don't give it up, someone's going to make you give it up. And I'm not trying to scare you or be mean or anything, but we see this all the time. So this puppy needs to start being trained immediately. Immediately. When I mean training, I'm talking real training. Not just sit every once in a while, not just paw. I'm talking about massive amounts of rules. You need to go through my whole program. Go get my baby proofing. Go get my baby proofing. I've got an online little class. Go to the 7 days to sanity. Seven, spell it out. 7 days to sanity. Go on, jump onto that and get that. It's a live streaming thing. But what I would do is I'd make sure that dog is crated at night, crated when you're not home, teach that dog place, have a leash on that dog at all times. I'd make sure you would monitor every single session. Never leave that dog alone with that child. All right. Teach the child that it's not a plaything. So you have to teach the child no as well. So 18-month-old child should understand no, let alone a three-year-old. So I know you can do it. I'm a father of seven. So I've had all my kids around my dogs. So what I want to make sure you do is you've got that puppy underneath extreme control. So let's stop that nipping and mouthing right now. The best thing you can do is you stick your thumb in the dog's mouth. You push down. You take yourself a bonker. A bonker is a wrapped up towel. You say no. You bonk the dog. But you also have to give that dog leadership and guidance, not just corrections all the time. Tell the dog what to do. Start now. That dog is learning every day. Every time it successfully duplicates a command, what that dog is doing, you know, what that dog is doing is it is learning that it's okay to do it. All right. I'm not mad at you. I'm not mad at anybody. I'm an intense human being and I'm passionate about my craft. So I want to make sure that dog stays in that house. Next.
Jay Hamlin. Jeff, I'm noticing some breeds such as Dutch Shepherds are super in tune with their defensive drive.
No.
With puppies that are the same, would you imply the same cut the shit or address differently?
So Jay, I'm being a family pet dog trainer and not a sport dog trainer, I absolutely tell dogs to cut the shit. I don't care what your breed is. I don't care what your breed is. Now, that's coming from a pet dog trainer standpoint, not a sport dog trainer standpoint. So if I was a sport dog trainer, I would have a different line of thinking on how I would be raising my working dogs. But I don't. I'd rather cut the shit. I'll teach you how to bite later. So I'll teach you how to bite later, but I understand the philosophy of a lot of sport dog folks redirecting. And if that's your craft and that's your level of expertise, I get it. But for me, I'm a family pet dog trainer. It's not acceptable. Next.
Siobhan says, bless you. Thanks.
You're welcome.
The KD. Thank you for answering. Good night and keep making this world a better place. Dogs are the shit.
The KD. Thank you so much. Thanks for that $5. Next.
Siobhan says, also always remember to smile and high-five strangers. Okay. S. Paul.
Will do.
My dog is so well behaved when he knows I have food in my pockets, but when I don't, he looks at me like, okay, fine, I'll sit.
S. Paul, punishment is lacking in your training protocol. What I mean by that is it's acceptable to punish a dog. Punishment is not a bad word. It's the actual factual thing that you do. You're not mad. You're not upset. You're not being mean to your dog. And it sure as hell ain't abuse. So when a dog knows a command and refuses to do a known command, the only way to get the dog to do it consistently and to stop objecting is through properly applied punishment. So if I say sit to a dog and it doesn't sit, I've got a prong collar on the dog, I've got a leash on the dog, I'd give it a very firm leash correction. If I had a remote collar on the dog, I'd give it a remote collar correction. We've already practiced sit 500 times. It does it every single time. When there's food, that means it knows it. So it's time to stop that. That's why you want to start adding punishment. You can still do some variable rewarding if you want to, but I don't food train my dogs and they listen. They're done. We're done. They're done learning basic obedience. Now I trick train. I don't do the trick training. Brittany, one of my trainers, trick trains the dog. I'm still a student of trick training and a very green student and a pretty damn rough one. I'll tell you that. I'm using food for that because my skill set is not where it's supposed to be. And I haven't done enough practice with my dogs. So, and also in trick training, we don't punish anyway. Agility, we don't punish, you know? So that's what's missing. That's what's missing. So when you get a selective learner or a stubborn dog, it's called lack of punishment. Next.
Crystal, I used to only use positive reinforcement and thought it was the best way and that prongs and e-collars were bad. I'm a convert. You've shown me that punishment is okay and my dog is better for it.
Yeah, I mean, this is the thing. We used a ton of it. But the concept that a reward only anything in life, why dogs don't get a free pass. Since when do dogs get a free pass? No animal gets a free pass. And if anybody ever says, well, look what they're doing at zoos and in SeaWorld. That's the biggest line of bullshit I've heard in my life. You want to talk about punishment? You want to talk about punishment? You keep a whale in a damn fishbowl? You take away the lack of free movement of that animal? That's the biggest punisher in the world. I can't imagine a bigger punishment than to keep an animal in such a small container. Sure, I crate dogs, not 24/7. You know, I ain't seen anybody taking any whales on little fishing excursions with them now. No. They use punishment all the time. Don't tell me, don't anybody throw, nobody has on this show because people know better. But if anybody's out there saying to themselves, well, zoos and SeaWorld and whatever, marine parks, they use positive only, that's the biggest line of fucking bullshit I've ever heard in my life. They're the ultimate in punishment. Well, it's called lack of free movement. It's called starvation. That doesn't mean they don't care about the animals. I'm not saying that. That doesn't mean people that work at zoos. Oh, damn itch. That doesn't mean that people aren't good people and don't care about those animals. But don't lie to yourself and don't sure as hell don't lie to me. The ultimate form of punishment is done at zoos and SeaWorld. Next.
Sonia, what is your opinion about pit bulls? In Montreal, they're banned because one killed a lady. Is this bad owner or do you think this dog is seriously dangerous?
It's neither. It's neither. One dog kills a person and we ban the whole breed? I don't believe there's a breed out there that should be banned at all. One dog kills a woman. That's terrible. That's terrible. Seven children a day die with texting and driving. You know what I mean? That's more terrible. 60 people are going to die this year from having coconuts fall on their head. That's even worse. I wouldn't ban anything for one. I wouldn't ban anything for 60. But it's not a bad owner. You know, there are a lot of bad owners out there that have dogs that aren't aggressive. So it's called being a dog. We forget that sometimes. Now, is that dog with the wrong owner? Could be. Could have been with a perfect owner. They just lost control of their dog. They didn't know what they had. So we got lots of good owners out there. I got lots of good owners out there whose dogs have killed other dogs. You know, they're not bad owners at all. So, next.
S. Paul, what's the difference between out and mine? Mine, I started using when I wanted him to drop his toy and give it to me.
I don't use mine, so I wouldn't know. So out means release whatever's in your mouth. Release what is ever in your mouth. That's what I do. Now, but these are just words. So I speak English. It sounds like you speak English. So we're both going to probably communicate it with our dogs in English. In other foreign-speaking countries and non-English-speaking countries, which there's many of, they most likely don't use English as a language. And they're still training their dogs using the spoken word. So what happens is if mine is your word for release what's in your mouth and give it to you, then mine it is. That's up to you. That would be personal choice. Next.
Crystal, dog hates riding in the car. He fights to get in, seems scared, tail between legs. And when he does get in, he shuts down and acts depressed, won't take food or interact. Thoughts?
Thoughts? You're humanizing your dog a little bit there, Crystal. You're humanizing your dog. Dog's not acting depressed, shut down maybe, won't take food. Of course not. Dog's afraid. What I want you to do is this. If I had that dog in my training center, I would do 1 week of training with it. And then I would say, we're going for a car ride. I'd put a crate in the back of my truck. I'd tell that dog to load up. But I've been practicing going into a crate in my training center all week. If the dog didn't load up, we'd work through it. It'd load up. I've also taught the dog how to lie down in a crate at the training center. It would lie down in the crate in my truck. I would drive away. It'd be in the back of the truck. I'd be driving. I wouldn't see it. I wouldn't know if it looked depressed or not. We'd arrive where we'd want to go. I'd go into the back. I'd clip a leash and collar back on that dog. I'd tell it to come out of the truck. I'd go about my business. That's what I would do. I wouldn't take no survey. I wouldn't ask the dog if he enjoyed the ride. Got it? And I wouldn't feed my dogs any snacks. It's a good way to get your nervous, fearful dog to throw up. Okay? Next.
Little Mama Mud, thanks. I will get the CBD oil. Box Rescue Remedy didn't do a thing. He's an old English sheepdog. We'll still join Patreon. Thank you so much. Hi, Joelle.
Hey, thanks. It's 2 hours and 2 minutes into the show. What time is it?
11 o'clock.
It's 11 o'clock. Guys, we got to go. All right. It's a 2 hour show. See, I told you we can do a 12 hour show.
Yeah. I'll need Red Bull. A lot of it.
We can make it work.
We'll do it.
Did you go out to dinner tonight? You look nice.
Yeah, I did.
Did you? Nice.
Yeah.
Would you go out with your sister? Mm-hmm. Nice. Good. All right, guys. Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. Thank you so much. We had a nice big audience tonight. Some fantastic questions. This week, I am traveling on Wednesday. Maybe we can do a show from the road. Would you just yawn?
Do it. No.
What's so funny?
You.
Oh. Okay.
Okay.
This week we can. I think we want to do a show from the road.
Sure.
Saturday night.
Sure.
Okay. It's Friday night. You get in Friday night. Mm-hmm. Saturday night we'll try to do either Saturday. No, Sunday night we leave. Sunday night we have to drive back.
Yeah. So
Saturday night because we'll be staying. Saturday night possibly at 9 p.m. we'll be doing a show. All right. Well, it depends on the we have good Wi-Fi. We can also do it inside the training center if we have to. They've got good Wi-Fi. So Saturday night, plan on another show. This Saturday night at 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Madly in love with you. Talk to you later. I appreciate every one of you. I appreciate you for sticking around. I appreciate you for participating. I love you all for your questions. For all the folks that do the super chat, I love you. For all the folks that just want to ask questions, it doesn't really matter to me. I've got no expectation of anything in return. Just having people that I can share information with, to me, is a reward enough. All right. Take care, everybody. Bye-bye.